is good. Genesis, Genesis, Genesis. If you can't find Genesis, I need to see you after church. Amen. Can't let you. I don't even want you to know you be a visitor. Don't even say you visited New Beach Grove. Amen. If you can't find Genesis. Amen. Genesis. Amen. Genesis. Let me give you, just open your Bible, the first page, and you'll be close to it. Amen. My goodness. Amen. Amen. Genesis chapter 22. Genesis chapter 22. Amen. Amen. Genesis chapter 22, verses 1 and 2. Amen. And it reads, sometime later, God tested Abraham. He said to him, Abraham, here am I, he replied. Then God said, take your son, your only son, Isaac, whom you love, and go to the region of Moriah. Sacrifice him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains I will tell you about. Lord Jesus. Look at this now. He said, take your son, your only son, Isaac, whom you love. Go to the region of Moriah. Sacrifice him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains I will tell you about. Lord, ask for your power to rest upon your servant and bring a word like only you can. Thank you, God, for this great church and this great membership. But Lord, we ask for you to take us to a new level in your glory. In the name of Jesus, we pray, amen. As you take your seats and go on and take them, because I got one of them old school titles, amen. I ain't got one of them Instagram tweetable ones, amen. The title kind of long. I felt like one of the old school preachers I grew up on, amen. The sermon today is, or the message is, who do you love more, the gift giver or the gift? Are you willing to sacrifice your Isaac? Who do you love more, the gift giver or the gift? Are you willing to sacrifice your Isaac? If you don't love your kid, just imagine you do. Amen. Tom Rainer, in his book, I Will, writes, he says, I can't put a specific date on it. Smarter people than I have tried to explain it. Somewhere in the 20th century, believers, particularly in America, began to shift from an attitude of self-sacrificing service to God and worship of God to consumer-focused, self-serving attitudes. It has been a terrible shift. Some blame it on secularization of our culture. Others point to the degradation of theology in our churches. Still others say local church leaders themselves have taken on corporate models and turned our churches into consumer-focused organizations. There's probably some truth to all three explanations, but there is one thing we can say with certainty. The focus in too many of our church worship services is not God. We are focused on ourselves, our own needs, and our own preferences. Even though most of us agree wholeheartedly with Brother Rainer that we have become selfish and need more to focus more on God, most of us find ourselves in a paradoxical dilemma with the story of God calling Abraham to sacrifice Isaac. This directive of God is a tough pill to swallow. How could a loving God suggest such a thing? It's not just incomprehensible, it's absolutely unconscionable. But the biblical stories that cause the most cognitive dissonance to our logical minds often contains the greatest revelations. Instead of dissecting scripture, we need to let scripture dissect us. Our thoughts and attitudes, our dreams and desires, our fears and hopes. Too often we approach stories like this one as if God is on trial. But it's not the character of God that is in question. It's our character that's on the stand. Oh, y'all don't want to hear that though, do you? And that is precisely why God tests us. If you're around my age or older, you heard the message, this message more than once. This is a test. For the next 60 seconds, this station will conduct a test of the emergency broadcast system. This is only a test. God never intended for Abraham to sacrifice his son. It was only a test. In fact, God would not have allowed him to slay Isaac. He simply wanted to test Abraham to see if he was willing to obey the most counterintuitive command imaginable. You know, God will ask you to do some stuff that don't make no sense. To make sure that you're not leaning on your own understanding. To make sure you're walking by faith and not by sight. To make sure that you're putting your faith in him and not yourself. Scripture explicitly reads, God tested Abraham and Abraham passed the test. That's how you get a testimony. No test, no testimony. Oh, so the next time you are tested, recognize it for what it is. A test is simply an opportunity for you to have a testimony. Come on, somebody. I know you want to be more than an overcomer, but how can you overcome something and you don't have anything to overcome? I know you want to be more than a conqueror, but we get an attitude when God puts an obstacle in the midst of our way so we can conquer it. How in the world can you fulfill Scripture if you don't have a test to create a testimony? Oh, you can't be no leader if you ain't tested. If you ain't tested and tried, you ain't worthy of leading. You can't lead if you can't handle controversy, baby. If you can't handle the test, stay on your level. See, you get testimonies when you're challenged and when you're battered and when you bruise. Testimonies are created in the wilderness situations. Come on, baby, not in the promised land. You ain't gonna get no testimonies while you eating your high class food. You don't have a real test in good times. Tell me something you learned when your life was going good. No, baby, it's when you go through those valley experiences, when you're in the darkness and you don't know who to turn to. You don't know who's going to be on your side. When you go through the darkness and when you walk through the valley of the shadow of death, that's when you understand that his rod and his staff shall comfort you. God gave Abraham several tests. In the Jewish custom, they say he gave him 10. But we all agree this was the final test. It was specifically designed to test whether or not Abraham was sold out to God. Some of us sold out, but what you sold out to, you just ponder on your own life. God tests us for two primary reasons. First is an opportunity for God to prove himself to us. Second is an opportunity for us to prove ourselves to God. See, that's why we should consider it a joy when we experience trials. They're the proving grounds. They're the way we graduate to the next level in the kingdom. See, God doesn't have a no child left behind policy like George Bush. Come on, somebody. He'll let you stay in the same spiritual grave for 30 years. Some folk been Christians for 30 and 40 years and still operating on the same level. I don't care how old you are. You can be an immature saint if you don't grow in the glory of God and pass your test, because God would not promote you until you pass. When I go through a test, I just hold up holy hands and I thank God, because Scripture said weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. But you know why I also shout Dr. Pugh? Because the word said that he prepares a place before me in the presence of my enemies. And until my enemies show their head, I'm not sure if I'm going to get blessed or not. But every now and then when the enemy touched me, every now and then, I know a blessing is around the corner. Because God doesn't bless anything before he tests it. The same way you got to take a test to go to the next grade. God give SOLs too, baby. Yeah. For my Georgia people, end of course testing, amen. But SOLs here is a standard of learning. That's what we, you got to take a test to go to the next level. But God has, you have to take a test to go to the next spiritual level. Aren't you tired of being on the same level?
Stop complaining about your test. See, the problem is we keep asking God, why me? You need to ask God, why is this happening and where do you want me to go? What do I need to accomplish? What do I need to learn? What in the world are you bringing to me so you can help take me to the next level? See, your test is your prerequisites to the next level in the kingdom. When Abraham raised the knife, God knew he was willing to sacrifice what was most precious to him. And God proved himself as Jehovah Jireh, his provider. If Abraham hadn't committed totally to the will of God, he would have robbed God the opportunity to provide a ram in the thicket. God cannot reveal his faithfulness until we exercise our faith. What are you holding on to that God is instructing you to let go so he can bless you? Oh, y'all don't hear what I'm saying. If I never would have been able to let go of Atlanta, I never would have been blessed with the pastor position of this great church called New Beach Grove. If I wouldn't have let go of my real estate company and let go of all the money I made, I never would have walked into the destiny God had for me. If I would have held on to what I felt like was the blessing that I wanted and used my common sense to realize the salary here was lower than what I was making at home. But Lord have mercy, will God make a way out of no way? God said, I open up the window of heaven and pour the blessing you won't have room to receive. You better learn how to go wherever God tells you to go, no matter what the pay look like, because God will bring you a blessing out of nowhere and you won't even know where it's coming from. But he can't give you a ram until you're willing to sacrifice your Isaac. See, if you have a dream that dies, it may be God testing you to see how important it is. See, look at this. God would never tempt you. It's not in his nature. He even promises to never allow anything that we are not able to handle to come upon us. This is one of the reasons God doesn't elevate you until you pass the test, because the next level of glory you go through, Brother Spells, the next level of demons you got to go to. Y'all don't hear me? See, the devil can only kill, steal, and destroy, which means he can't create no more demons. He only can use the same demons he got. He got to be very resourceful in his little demonic kingdom. Come on, somebody. God can make an angel or how many angels he wants to when he wants, but the devil can never make any more demons, so he's limited at his resources. So he's not going to send a demon on a higher level to mess with me. If a lieutenant can handle me, he ain't going to send a captain. You feel me? And see, what you need to understand is if you operating on a captain level, if that's where your potential lies for the next step, you're going to be dealing with the captain demon, even though you're on a lieutenant level. Y'all don't hear what I'm saying. See, the problem is you think the devil is attacking you for the level you own. No, he's attacking you for the level you're about to go to. Oh, y'all don't hear what I'm saying. And see, you can't make it to that level. See, you know what the devil is? The devil is a toll booth collector. Come on, somebody. He's a toll booth collector. You know how you're going down the Merrimack and then you got to stop at the toll booth and pay them if you don't have the little pass card, and they sitting there and sometimes they got an attitude because everybody is going somewhere but them. Whatever, now and then you have a toll booth collector and the devil comes up. But see, the devil don't just come up and show up with his pitchfork. The devil comes in the form of the person in the next cubicle every now and then. The toll booth collector sometimes comes in the midst of your supervisor. The toll booth collector sometimes comes in the midst of police brutality or racism or sexism. Sometimes the devil comes in all shapes inside to make sure. Sometimes he walking with his high heels on. Had to talk to you for a while. Yeah, sometimes it comes in the form of a brick house. Yeah. Sometimes it comes with a nice tie on and a suit and a Benz and a Beamer. Will you pass the test to go to the next level? Yeah, he will test you. See, God won't tempt you, but he will indeed test your faith. And the tests don't get easier. Your test in the fifth grade, unless you was in a little room, got harder than your first grade test.
I can say that. I used to teach special ed, so I don't care if y'all get mad.
They get progressively harder as the stakes get higher. And those tests will undoubtedly revolve around what is most important to you. See, he will test you in what you identify yourself in and what you find security in. He will test you with your Isaac. God will test you to make sure your identity and security are rooted in the cross and the blood of Jesus Christ. God will go after anything you trust more than him until you put it on the altar.
Oh.
See, you don't have to live in fear wondering if God is going to take away what is most important to you. Remember, Isaac was God's gift to Abraham. But if the gift ever becomes more important than the gift giver, then the very thing God gave you to serve his purposes is undermining his plan for your life. When God is no longer your everything and you begin to call on God like a cook to order chef, that's the beginning of the end of spirituality. Oh, God-given gifts are wonderful and dangerous. Oh, come on, somebody. Y'all don't hear what I'm saying. See, a fire is good in the fireplace. A fire is bad on your roof. Don't. You ain't going to be singing that song, Let It Burn. When we use the gifts for his glory, they are wonderful. When we begin to use the gifts for our own selfish gain or for the love of the gift more than the gift giver, they become dangerous. You understand? Because the gifts are given without repentance. God is not going to take your ability. That's why you got to be careful, especially us preachers. You can be preaching and people going to heaven and you on your way to hell. I don't want God to say, get ye behind me, you worker of iniquity. I never knew you. Come on, somebody. God has still gifted you in the midst of your mess because the gift is for not for your glory anyway. He'll give it to you when you're walking in holiness. He'll give it to you when you're walking messed up. He'll give it to you when you're doing right. He'll still let you have it when you're doing wrong. They're given without repentance. So my prayer is always this: Lord, whatever you use me for, don't let me use it and go to hell. Judas' whole purpose was to betray Jesus and go to hell. I don't want to be Judas. Oh, I know y'all don't hear about sin in church and stuff. Yeah. Don't worry about it. I'm sweating for a reason. If your dream dies, it may be God testing you to see what is important to you. What is more important to you, the dream or him? Which do you love more, the dream God gave you or the God who gave you the dream? See, is your dream a means of glorifying God? Catch this now. Is your dream a means of glorifying God? Or is your dream the end goal and God is the means of fulfilling it? Huh? Are you trying to use God to get what you want? Oh, y'all don't hear what I'm saying. Or do you want what God wants and you're going to glorify him? Oh, y'all don't hear what I'm saying. Y'all, you'll get it when you go home. God-ordained dreams aren't just born. They are reborn. If they become more important to you than God, you have to sacrifice them for the sake of your soul. You have to put them on the altar and raise the knife. And once your dream is dead and buried, it can be resurrected for God's glory. Let me tell you something about the InTouch situation or the InTouch event that we did on last year, where the entire city, Hampton and Newport News and the police, the fire departments from Hampton and Newport News and all around. And they came. Please make sure Brother Drone knows that the state troopers are invited this year. I forgot to invite him last year, and I thought he was going to give me a ticket. He looked highly upset. You know Brother Drone don't talk that much. But when he do, you be scared when he ain't smiling. Hey, so just make sure he knows they invited. Amen. And we had the city, and it was big. And I mean, we had a lot. We had hundreds of people out there. And then God said to me, through Bishop Dawson, when we had a meeting with a couple of deacons, he said, you need to let them things go. And I received it because he says, you got to let it go because you need to grow your people. They don't understand covenant. They don't understand certain things that you're putting out there. And that's causing the friction in your church because you're giving them some spiritual things that they aren't quite elevated enough to understand. And he said, you need to turn your attention on your church and grow them up. Because if you grew them up, they wouldn't have a problem with the covenant because they would understand what a covenant agreement is. And so I said, yes, sir. And I said, I'm going to leave it alone and I'm not going to do it. And then all of a sudden, God brought the leadership and the church in order. Just like that. Poof. You know what I'm saying? Just like God. Just snap a finger. You know, Bewitch and Gina ain't got nothing on God. You know, they can move their little nose and blink their eye, but God just made it happen. You understand what I'm saying? Just made it happen. So then, because God got the leadership in order now, I can teach the leadership and bring them up because they're in order. See, it's hard to teach folk when they ain't in order because they don't want to hear you. But God brought everything in order. So then I got a call from the city, and the city said, well, you know, when you did InTouch last year, this is what we want you to do. We want you to have a tournament for the southeast side, the central side, and the north side. And then Hampton want to do a game, and they want to feed into it. So then the two teams, then we started getting together, the two teams from each of the districts will come in and have the big game. And we're going to have, so we got five tournaments fully funded by the city. Come on, somebody. We ain't got to pay for nothing. When you begin... And see, that was my baby. That was what God birthed in me. So for him to tell me to let it go, I didn't understand it. But when he said let it go, I let it go. And when you let it go, he was able to rebirth it back. Until you let something die, God can't rebirth it again. Let it go. Let it go. I had to remix this song. I think I better let it go. What? What? I'm about to make it a kingdom song. Yeah, boy, I think I better let it go. Because if I do, God gonna give me some more. Hey. Anyway. The Holy Spirit is the dream maker. Just as he hovered over the chaos at the dawn of creation, he overshadows all creation. The Holy Spirit is the one who spawns the thought that creates the dream inside of you. He, if you nurture the thought with prayer and remain in agreement with the Holy Spirit, if it will become a God-sized dream. See, I'd rather have a God idea, one God idea, than 1,000 good ideas. See, good ideas are good. But God ideas transform communities and change the course of history. You can get good ideas from a lot of places. You get it from school, you get it from people, you get it from watching a movie. But the God idea only comes from the Holy Spirit. Isaac was God's idea. It was God who proclaimed the promise to Abraham and conceived the promise with Sarah. Look here within Sarah. Now don't get mad at me. This is just what she was. Postmenopausal octogenarians don't have children. Ever. But God always delivers what he conceives if you're willing to go through the labor pain. Oh, see, y'all don't hear what I'm saying. See, are you willing to go through the labor pains? Come on, somebody. I had a whole bunch of labor pains at this job I had for about 5 years. Not this job, this other church. You know what I'm talking about? So, labor pains. God will birth whatever you can take the pain of. Oh, y'all don't hear what I'm saying. See, this is what leaders don't understand. They ain't trying to offend nobody, whether it be church or whether it be Coca-Cola, whatever it be. The devil pay his tithes faithfully. If you got 100 folk, 10 folk there from the devil. If you got 1,000 folk, 100 folk there from the devil. I'm telling you, God can transform them, but every now and then you need some negative charges in your life. See, a battery don't work unless you have a positive and negative charge, because it won't flow. You got to have the negative charge to ground it. If that's not a ground wire and I turn the lights on in this place, the church will blow up if it's not grounded. Sometimes God puts some stuff in your life to keep you grounded so you won't get the big head and think you all that. He allows you to go through tests to keep you humble. But he also will give you a dream far bigger than yourself. Ain't nowhere in the world Abraham thought he did something. Ain't no way in the world. He know he couldn't have done nothing. He done had this child with this lady who's barren. He impotent in the time of BV. Before Viagra. God will give you an impossible blessing, an impossible test, an impossible task, test you to the point of your limitations to make sure you know it ain't you. Oh, y'all don't hear me? See, in fact, if God would have kept interest the same size, it would have run the risk of me getting the big head, because if I did it the same size, I already know exactly how it worked the last time, so all I got to do is do what I did last time. But I didn't know how to do it last time because it was still bigger than something I ever done. God, see, if your dream can be accomplished by you, it ain't God's dream. It's just that, your dream. And the reason why people get stretched, Brother Shaw, with leadership, kingdom leadership, is because it always stretches you and it overwhelms you. And some of y'all get mad because anytime I walk in a room, I'm overwhelming you because I'm doing something bigger than you and I'm doing something bigger than me because I don't trust me. I don't trust you either. But I don't trust me. I trust God. And the only way for God to be ignited is for me to walk by faith and not by sight. As long as we doing what we can do. See, the problem, Brother Johnson, is everybody want to see the possible. They forget they in church. This ain't the shipyard. This ain't Fort Eustis. This ain't Lane, this ain't the school system. This is the kingdom of God, and God gives you vision bigger than yourself. What if Abraham and Sarah would have never believed what God's promise was? They never would have received their Isaac if they looked at their own limitations. She was barren, and he was impotent. But God still brought it through. Because they was able to go through and endure the labor pains. See, I get to the point, I never get excited about anything. Brother Smith, rarely. I know I'm passionate when I preach, but I don't get excited about much. I'm an even keel kind of person, because as you lead, you can't let the hand claps get you too high. Because when the backstabbers come, you will go too low. You know. And sometimes you got to understand that some folk clapping for you is just Palm Sunday people. They loving you today, but they will kill you tomorrow. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Hosanna, they said, one day. String him up, they said, the next day. And if they did that to Jesus, I'm just saying. God has a way of keeping your cross before you to make sure that you don't love the blessing more than him. Oh, y'all don't hear what I'm saying. When I came here, I was highly excited. Everything was great, but God made sure he kept me humble. He kept some testers around me. He kept the thorn in my side. And he made me make sure I never said, they go to, when somebody say, oh, if I even overhear people say, I go to Maxwell's church. No, you go to New Beach Grove. I don't ever say my church. I say I pastor at New Beach Grove, God's house. You never hear me. You'll never hear me say, even though you can say it's maybe, but because you know you ain't the pastor. But if I say, when preachers start saying my church and my ministry and my this and start wanting to own stuff and own all this stuff, they begin to run the risk of letting people think that they're more important than God. So I don't even want to start there. See, people that let people worship them started somewhere, and it started with my. You can't say my about anything. Once you come to Jesus, you got to drop that personal pronoun. You got to drop my, me, and mine. It ain't yours. Every good and perfect gift comes from God, not you. He gave you the power to obtain wealth. It's him that blessed you, not yourself. He's the author and finisher of your faith, not you. He who began a good work shall finish it, not you. It's not yours. Your car not yours. Your house not yours. Sister girl will let you know your wife ain't yours either. You ain't got to worry about that. She'll tell you. Your car may not speak, but let me tell you everything else. Sister girl gonna let you know. I ain't even put y'all in trouble and say they don't own y'all. I ain't gonna even. In the spirit, yes, but for the sake of your safety, I'm not gonna say that. Hallelujah. See, the early Methodists devoted themselves entirely to God with a covenant prayer that goes like this. It says, I'm no longer my own, but thine. Put me to what thou wilt, rank me with whom thou wilt, put me to doing, put me to suffering, let me be employed for thee or laid aside for thee, exalted for thee or brought low for thee. Let me be full, let me be empty, let me have all things, let me have nothing. I freely and heartily yield all things to thy pleasure and disposal. And now, O glorious and blessed God, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, thou art mine and I am thine, so be it. And the covenant which I have made on earth, let it be ratified in heaven. Amen. Do you find your identity in who you are or whose you are? See, that subtle nuance makes all the difference in the world. But this one, both in this world and the next. See, you can base your identity on 1,000 things, the degrees you have, the wife or the husband you got, the sorority or the fraternity you in, your job, your house, your car. But if you put in your identity in that, you are unstable. Because if a storm comes in life and you lose it, you will lose your identity too. You can't put your identity in anything but the bloodstained banner of Jesus Christ. And see, the problem is you can't trust God 99%. You know what the problem is? I was going to call him Brother Reynolds, but he's taking a nap. But I'm just playing, man. I'm sorry. I'm turning around. Security. I'm sorry, man. I'm sorry. See? Yeah. I'm going this side. So, you didn't make me get where I was. What'd I say? Huh? Every church God, thank you. You can't just trust Jesus 99%. You got to trust him 100%. The problem is, Sister Shaw, we want to at least take 1% of everything we do right. At least 1%. I did it. No, it's all grace or no grace. See, you know what I love about not taking credit? I don't take the blame either. If it mess up and I did what God said, maybe he wanted to fail. See, they say God can do everything but fail. God can fail if he wants to. They need to stop limiting God. God can do everything but fail. God can fail if he wants to. Huh? He made creation and repented and started all over again. He chose Saul and repented. So if God wants to fail, he can. So even when you fail, it may be God putting you through a test to see if you trust him more than your blessing. Y'all don't hear what I'm saying? Your failures are even your blessings, because all the steps of a righteous man or woman are ordered of the Lord, and all things happen for the good of those who are called according to his purpose. If you call, even your failures are blessings. Because he's just orchestrating you to get you where he wants you. So, the question is this. What do you need to give up? What do you need to put on the altar? What is getting between you and God? What feeds your ego? Where do you find your security outside of Christ? Sometimes that's your Isaac, because sometimes even what God has given you can become an idol, because God will exalt himself in you, which means you will be exalted as well. But some of us ain't even got to our Isaac yet. We still holding on to Ishmael and won't even let Ishmael go. So if you can't let Ishmael go, I know you can't let Isaac go. See, the harder you have to work for something, the harder it is to give up. And the longer you have to work for it, the tougher it is to give back. That's why Abraham's moment was so amazing when he was willing to give up Isaac. Why? Because I'm trying to preach over you, baby. I'm trying. Everything. He tried. So much. He had done too much to just give it up. He had to give it up, though. He been impotent. He done already got kicked out the house, y'all, because he done messed with the woman his wife told him to mess with. I turned this way so y'all wouldn't be looking at me. I would look at a few. All these unmarried people won't shoot me yet, you know. Oh, yeah, she might shoot me. Hold on. But... I'm talking to y'all. Nah, y'all get in trouble. Anyway, you know what I'm saying. He had to work too hard to get Isaac. But then God said, let it go. Have you ever not let go of what God wanted you to let go of? Has God ever told you to bless somebody that you didn't like and you didn't bless them? Has God ever told you to let go of a certain amount of money? If you can't let go of, you realize, ain't it funny, ain't it ironic that we have in God we trust printed on what we trust him the least with? Oh, y'all don't hear me. Boy, start talking about tithing and watch people's head go down. It's my money. See, do you realize testimony and test of money almost sound alike? Testimony, test of money, because where your treasure lies, so does your heart lie. And if when you really start giving your money to God, see, we still got leaders. I ain't calling them names on because I don't know it no way. I'm just saying, so don't get scared. Maybe you'll be scared straight. You still have leaders, even leaders in churches, not just this church. You even got pastors that don't tithe. You already showing you don't trust God. God don't want your tip. Y'all to be at the restaurant talking about, should I give a 10 or 15%? And you sit up there, should I give God 2 or 3? When you pass the test of money, you will pass everything else. If Abraham wasn't willing to tithe, I bet you he wouldn't have been willing to sacrifice Isaac. But anyway. But the more God blesses you with, the harder it is to give up. If you ain't going to give a dollar out your 10, come on, somebody. You ain't giving 10,000 out your 100,000. If you can't give a dollar out your 10, how can God elevate you to get more blessings? Some of us on the same level because we ain't passed that test right there. Now, this wasn't in my sermon, but this must be for somebody. Some of us need to pass the test of money. That's where your heart at. Some folk, you know, some folk are getting mad, and it's in the book that I'm reading, I Will, and we're gonna do that. Well, I already read it, it's so short, but we're gonna study that book the same way we did I'm a Christian. We're gonna order the books, and you can get it from the church. We're gonna sell it at cost, and we'll get it without paying taxes, so you just get it from us. But we're gonna do that book, I Will. But it talks about how some folk get mad and will hold their tithes because they mad. Tithes ain't got nothing to do with you and me. Tithing ain't got nothing to do with you and New Beach Grove. Your tithe had to do with your covenant with God. God said, you bring your full tithe to the storehouse. I open up the windows of heaven and pour the blessing you won't have room to receive. I rebuke the devourer. I rebuke the pestilence and the locust. Whatever tries to come against you, I will handle. When you pay your tithes, come on somebody. When you pay your tithes and you give your offerings to God, God is obligated to take care of you. It's almost, I don't want to go into that. I'm ready to get out of here. I'm trying. You ever seen, I was watching The Godfather. Little Godfather Marathon. And when I talk to you about this, is this. It's funny how the people will pay gangsters for their protection and know if I pay them this money, I'm good. It protects me from them and the other folk. You feel me? So you ain't just paying for the gangster to protect you from other folk. You paying them to protect, you know, to protect you from them. You know, if you pay them, you good. And you should be good everywhere else. Now, if gangsters can get that order with human beings, why can't we get that order with the ultimate OG God? You feel me? If we begin to take care of the things of God and begin to give back to God what he gave us anyway. See, the thing about this Isaac situation is God gave Abraham Isaac anyway. Abraham was just in the point of willing to give back what God had already given to him. Once you realize that you own nothing and all the blessings come from God, every good and perfect gift comes from him, you won't be worried about giving God what it is you're supposed to give him. 100% of your money is God's. He only asking for 10%. But then when you tithe, he giving it all back anyhow. See, the thing about it with God, God ain't gonna never let you outgive him. Ever. Ever. If you give to him, he gonna give it back. The reason why God sent Jesus, because hold on. Abraham can't look better than me. If he willing to give up his son, you know what, let me just give you. You know what, forget all these goats and turtle doves, I'm gonna give you my son. See? God doesn't bless you financially to be selfish and get a bigger car or more cars. Not saying there's anything wrong, but God blesses you to bless other people. God blesses you to bless the kingdom. Once you understand that you're not blessed for yourself, but you're blessed for the glory of God, you will learn how to give to God. And you know what it'll also do? It also make you stop feeling bad when you fall. Now, yes, you should feel bad when you fall. You should remorse, but it won't stop you from serving because you understand that this gift is not for me anyway. This gift of singing God gave me is for God. This gift of preaching God gave me is for God. This gift of teaching God gave me is for God. This money God gave me is for God. Everything God gave me was for his glory. So as long as I know that I'm a steward and I do exactly with whatever blessing God gave me with, for whatever Isaac God gave me, I'm willing to give it back to him. You know why? Because every good and perfect gift comes from God. God gave me Isaac. God gave me my house. God gave me my wife. God gave me my truck. God gave me my job. God gave me my career. God gave me my degree. But I don't find my identity in none of that stuff. You know why? You got to learn how to trust the gift giver more than the gift. Do you love your car more than God? Do you love your wife more than God? Do you love your husband more than God? Whatever you love more than God, I bet you he gonna make you burn it. He gonna make you put it on the altar. If you don't put it on the altar, he'll put it on there himself, because God said you will not love anything more than me. I was reading scripture, and I think I was talking to Deacon Easley, and was talking about, you know, wives and all that stuff, and Adam blamed his blessing for causing him to fall. And when he ate the forbidden fruit, he said, "That lady you gave me, she made me do it." Yeah. She made me do it. God said, you ain't gonna blame me for that. And you know, ever since then, God said, a man that find a wife, find a good thing. God, like, I ain't gonna even find your wife for you. You do that on your own. That's what I had to learn. God isn't gonna drop no wife. I've been waiting all this time. God said, ain't nobody gonna blame me for that no more. A man that find a wife, find a good thing. But I ain't giving nobody not one wife. Because you ain't going to be like Adam and blame me for nothing she told you to do. But what I'm saying is this. God won't give you anything that comes between you and him. If that car will fall short, make you fall short, he'll take it. Or you won't even get it. If that promotion will make you too arrogant, he won't give it to you. You know why? Because he chastised those who he loves. He don't want the blessing to take you to hell. He don't want the blessing to cause you to fall. God will give you anything you can handle without becoming arrogant and greedy. You're wondering why you're not blessed? Maybe you ain't passed the test. Maybe you love the gift more than the gift giver. Maybe if you've not proven to God that you're willing to sacrifice your Isaac. If you're not willing to give up your Isaac, God's not going to give you your Isaac. You feel me? What is it that you need to give up for God? Listen, let me say this. I'm going to end with this. What blessing are you willing to give up to be blessed? You holding on tight to the blessing that God's telling you to let go of. And until you let go of the blessing, he can't give you anything else. What are you chasing more than God? What are you loving more than God? Check yourself and see what it is you need to give up. What Isaac do you need to release that God may take away just to give back to you? If I didn't let go of In Touch, one tournament games, one tournament with the city, when the game five. Oh, y'all don't hear what I'm saying. When you give God what you love the most back, he'll take it away and multiply it. But God can't give you anything back multiplied that you ain't willing to give up. When you give up your Isaac, God will always have a ram in the bush. Who? You know what? I'm gonna just tell you this. Let me tell you this. It's funny. Look at this. Look at this. It just hit me right now. He still required a sacrifice. Oh, y'all don't hear what I'm saying. But Abraham didn't have to sacrifice what he loved the most. He once done that ram. See, when you give up your biggest thing, that's the test that's your test you got to pass. And once you give that up, all that other stuff that God tell you to give up, you won't even care. Because what he's doing is making room for your blessings. He's making room for that good and perfect gift.